Hello, I hope all is well. I hope everybody's having a blessed day. Thank you very much for coming to this channel. May God continue to bless you and your family. Happy blessed Sunday. I know you guys should be relaxing, enjoying the weekend. So today is going to be a very powerful message. Today the message is, even though you brought yourself in a mess, you can still see the glory of God. This is a powerful message because many of times we find ourselves in situations that even though we're at fault, God can still deliver and come to the rescue. So it's going to be a very powerful prophetic message. But before we start this message, let's do a quick prayer. In the name of Jesus, in the almighty name of Jesus, Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for this day. I want to thank you for our family, friends, and acquaintances. I want to thank you for our good health, Heavenly Father. I want to thank you for waking us up today, giving us sight, giving us food, giving us water. Oh, Heavenly Father, there's so many people who don't have all this luxury. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you're doing, for what you've done and you continue doing. Heavenly Father, forgive us for our sins. For us to say we haven't sinned will make us liars. For all have fallen short of your glory, all have sinned. I have even sinned, Heavenly Father. Forgive us, wash us clean, and have mercy. May your grace, favor, and mercy continue to abide us, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, give us this day our daily bread. Give us divine protection and intervention. Give us the oil of restoration and restitution. Rakata, rakata, rakata. Eke mo se, elima, elima. Shandamo, shandamo. Heavenly Father, everywhere we go, we take our possession. We are the kings. We're the heads and not the tail, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, wherever we go, whichever enemy wants to attack us, fight them, Heavenly Father. Fight our battles. Fight our unforeseen and unseen battles. For you know of yesterday, you know of today, you know of tomorrow. Rakata, rakata, rakata. Eke mo se. Elima, elima. Shata mo se te mo se. Shakata, rakata, rakate. Elima, elima. Rakata. Eke mo papa. Eke mo mama. Shanda mo, shanda mo. Eke mo yeke. Eke mo papa. Elima, elima. Rakata. Ugo te, ugo yema, yema. Eke mo papa. Elima, elima. Heavenly Father, may this message that I'm about to preach win so many souls, Father Lord. May you use me mightily to deliver this powerful message, Heavenly Father. May it be a blessing, Father Lord. May our hearts receive it. May our hearts not be hardened, Heavenly Father. Every power from the pit of hell that wants to fight against this ministry, against this message, may the Lord arrest you. Rakata, Eke Mose, Elima. Open up our eyes to see your face. Open up our ears to hear your voice. Give us wisdom and understanding of your ways, Heavenly Father. May you minister this word. May you be the one ministering and be guiding me. Rakata, ekemo papa, elima, elima, shandamo, shandamo. We thank you for this day, Heavenly Father. Continue to be with us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. So yeah, even though you brought yourself in a mess, you will still see the glory of God. Amen. So we're going to break this message down into 3 points. The first point is going to be understanding your fault. The second point is sin invites suffering, but God is still merciful. He's still merciful and he's still faithful. The third point is personal testimonies because I have personally seen the glory of God. So let's go to the first point, understanding your faults. Understanding your faults. Let's go to James chapter 1 verse 13. 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 Let me quickly look for that verse. James chapter 1 verse 13. Chapter 1 verse 13. It's just slow. James chapter 1 verse 13. Okay, James chapter 1, verse 13. It says, let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. You see, many of times when we find ourselves in a situation, a mess that we created, we want to blame God. We want to hold God responsible. We want to hold God responsible. But God is not going to tempt you for you to do evil, because he doesn't desire for any to perish. You see, so when we're in a mess, we gotta try to understand our fault. We gotta understand our fault. You see, a lot of people, they keep making the same mistakes. They keep making the same mistakes. They find themselves in a mess because they're the ones who keep creating it. They keep living in their sinful ways. They don't follow God's principles. They keep doing things that is contrary to God. So we got to understand that a lot of times it's our fault that we're in that mess. It's our fault. Let's go to Romans chapter 6, verse 23. 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 Verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. It says the wages of sin is death. You see, this connects to my second point. Sin invites suffering. The wages of sin is death. Sickness can be a byproduct. Sin leads to your destruction. People need to understand their fault. People will drink alcohol excessively, and then they get liver damage or something. They want to be angry with God. But you're in that mess because you created it. You created that mess. People will sleep around. I have children everywhere. And then they'll blame God for their financial difficulties. They'll blame God because they can't find a good man. You put yourself in that mess. A lot of pastors will not tell you this, but we need to understand our faults. We need to understand our faults. Let's go to Psalms chapter 119. Psalms chapter 119. Psalms chapter 119. Psalms chapter 119, verse 13. Verse 13. Verse 37, amen. Verse 37. Verse 37. Turn away my eyes from beholding vanity, and quicken thou me in thy way. So we got to understand our faults. We got to understand that our ways are crooked, but God's ways are straight. Back in the Garden of Eden, if they had just been obedient to God, if they had just followed the straight way, a lot of this wouldn't have befallen us. For a lot of people, if they hadn't chosen that alcohol, if they hadn't chosen that drug, if they hadn't chosen their vanity ways, a lot of the problems they find themselves in will not even exist. It will be non-existent. So we got to understand our faults. Let's go to Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. The prophet Hosea. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. Stand up. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. Chapter 4, verse 6. My people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. You see, just that first line, we don't even have to read the full verse. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. This modern generation, they don't understand spiritual things. They don't understand soul ties. They don't understand fasting. They don't understand dreams. They don't understand revelation, prophecy. You see, we also have a lack of knowledge. We have a lack of knowledge about God. We have a lack of knowledge that there are spiritual entities, principalities, and powers that want to destroy us. We have a lack of knowledge about scripture, prophecy. We have a lack of knowledge about you reap what you sow, which other religions call karma. This lack of knowledge brings us in mess. We have a lack of knowledge about finances. We have a lack of knowledge about fornication, marriage. We have a lack of knowledge of these spiritual things, and that's most of the time why we find ourselves in messes also. But God is still faithful. God is still merciful. He still has grace for his people. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 14, verse 12. 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 Proverbs chapter 14. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 12. Chapter 14, verse 12. There's a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. You see, lack of understanding. There's a way that seems right unto us, but it leads to death. It leads to our own destruction. There's a way that seems right to get wealth, drug dealing, stealing, ripping people off, a pharmacy industry. There's a way that seemeth right unto man, but it's crooked and it leads to destruction. But if you follow that right way, you will not. A lot of these messages will not be in your life. It will not befall you. There's a way that seems right to man. Fornication, having children everywhere. Baby daddy drama. There's a way that seems right unto man. But it leads to death. It leads to the destruction. May that not be our portion. Let's go to Matthew chapter 6 verse 33. Matthew chapter 6 verse 33. We got to understand that a lot of times, these messages would have been avoidable. Where I fought. Matthew chapter 6 verse 33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. You see, we also don't seek first the kingdom. In a lot of these messes, we don't seek first the kingdom. If we had kingdom mindset, we wouldn't have the time for fornication, to be chasing after all these lustful things that vex our soul, that are vanity. We wouldn't be chasing after all these things that gives us restless nights, that gives us stress, that brings sickness. A lot of people are chasing money so much that they don't even sleep or eat properly anymore. They start getting sickness. You overworked your body. You're supposed to rest. Even God had rested. It's because we're seeking so many worldly things, lustful things, that we find ourselves in these messes. We find ourselves in these messes. Let's go to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2 verse 16. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of this world. You see, all these things of this world, they create messes. All this lust, you see somebody in the house, they must stress themselves out to buy a bigger house to impress their friends, getting more debt, getting more financial difficulties. The lust of the eyes. You'll see a man, he has a wife, but he's lusting after another woman because she looks more appealing. Maybe she's in better shape. He goes cheat on his wife. But that woman brings drama to his life. Baby daddy issue. Child support. You see, the lust of the eyes is not of God. It's of this world. It's what's bringing us into all these messes we find ourselves. But despite all of this, God is still faithful and merciful and graceful, especially when we turn to him. So let's go to our second point. Sin invites suffering, but God is still merciful. Let's go to John chapter 5. John chapter 5. John chapter 5. John chapter 5. John chapter 5 verses 2 to 14. 2 to 14. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In this lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool, and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. Wow, he had this infirmity most of his life, 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he saith unto him, Would thou be made? When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time, in that case he saith unto him, Would thou be made whole? The important man answered him, Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool, but while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. Jesus said unto him, Rise, take up thy bed and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, It is the Sabbath day, it is not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. He answered them, He that made me whole, the same said unto me, Take up thy bed and walk. Then asked they him, What man is that which said unto thee, Take up thy bed and walk? And he that was healed was not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself a multitude being in that place. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple and said unto him, Behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. You see, Jesus said, Sin no more, unless a worse thing will come unto him. Meaning, the guy had found himself important because of sin. You see, in the beginning, God is having grace, mercy to heal him, to show his glory. But verse 14, it says, Behold, you are made whole. Sin no more unless a worse thing come unto thee. So our sin is what invites suffering. But even though you find yourself in a mess, you will still see the glory of God. God is still graceful and merciful. God can refine that mess to strengthen you, to show him, to come into your life and show you his love. Amen. Amen. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 1, verse 2 through 19. Isaiah chapter 1, verses 2 through 19, verse 2. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord hath spoken. I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me. The ox knoweth his owner, and the ass his master's crib, but Israel does not know, my people does not consider. Ah, sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, a seed of evil doers, children that are corruptors, they have forsaken the Lord, they have provoked the Holy One of Israel to anger. They are gone away backward. Why should ye be stricken any more? Ye will revolt more and more. The whole head is sick and the whole heart faint. From the sole of the foot even unto the head, there is no soundness in it, but wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. They have not been closed, neither bound up, neither mollified with ointment. Your country is desolate. Your cities are burnt with fire. Your land, strangers devour it in your presence, and it is desolate as overthrown by strangers. And the daughter of Zion is left as a cottage in a vineyard, as a lodge in a garden of cucumbers, as a besieged city. Except the Lord of hosts had left unto us a very small remnant, we should have been as Sodom, and we should have been like unto Gomorrah. Hear the word of the Lord, ye rulers of Sodom. Give ear unto the law of our God, ye people of Gomorrah. To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me, saith the Lord? I am full of burnt offerings, of rams, and of the fat of the fed beasts, and I delight not in the blood of bullocks, or of lambs, or of he goats. When ye come to appear before me, we have required this at your hand to tread my cause. Bring no more vain oblations, incense. It's an abomination unto me. The new moons and Sabbaths, the calling of assemblies, I cannot away with. It is iniquity, even the solemn meaning. Your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hateth. They are a trouble unto me. I am weary to bear them. And when ye spread forth your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Yeah, when you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doing from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. Plead for the widow. Come now and let us reason together, save the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. You see, the people's sin, disobedience towards God, his principles, is what led to their suffering. And they keep sinning and sinning. But despite that, God is calling them unto himself. He's still showing grace, mercy. He wants to cleanse them of their sin. You see, another thing with understanding our faults is also have a repentance heart. Also have a repentance heart. Also have a heart to say, God, I have wronged. I find myself in this fault. I am at fault. But come in and fix up this mess. God was faithful. God is still calling his people. He still wants to cleanse and fellowship with them. So even when we find ourselves in fire, God can still take us out of that fire and refine and strengthen us. Amen. He can still refine and strengthen us. Let's go to 1 John chapter 1 verse 9. 1 John chapter 1 verse 9. First John chapter 1 verse 9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You see, God is merciful, graceful. He, at the end of the day, he desires none to perish. He desires repentance. He desires us to come back into him. Even though we have a lot of messes, when we still come back to his throne of grace, mercy, we will see the glory of God. Amen. We will see the glory of God. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. Chapter 10, verse 13. Chapter 10, verse 13. Chapter 10, verse 13. Verse 13, there have no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. You see, even though we find ourselves in a mess and all that temptation, God is still faithful to us to provide an escape, because God loves us that much. God loves us that much. So let's go to my third point, personal testimonies. Personal testimony, because I've personally seen the glory of God. I've been in messes that have been my fault, but God has delivered because he's faithful. Let's go to Jeremiah chapter 31. Jeremiah chapter 31. Jeremiah chapter 31. Jeremiah chapter 31 verse 25. Verse 25. For I have satiated the weary soul, and I have replenished every sorrowful soul. You see, God, he's a God that can wipe away your soul. He's a God that will take away your worries. Even though you find yourself in a mess, there are a lot of Christians that find themselves in a lot of messes because they have peace, but they still have peace because they have that confidence that God will deliver. And when you hear my testimonies, you'll have that confidence. I'm not just preaching to preach. I am preaching because I personally experienced, encountered, and seen the glory of God. Amen. So personal testimonies. There was one time that God refunded a check. So before he had refunded me money that was stolen, almost three years ago, I was trying to buy something online. And I used cash and I used Zelle to send the money to purchase the item. I soon realized that the item was not real and I lost money. And I tried to contact Zelle, but Zelle was not trying to refund. And about 2 years later, I was at a church and a man of God started prophesying and anointing us with oil that whatever money has been stolen or held us from us, God will return it. So about like 2 weeks later, I'm behind my bills and I receive a check in the mail from Zelle. That same money that was stolen a year prior, God had refunded it. And it came just at the right time when I needed money for serious expenses. You see, even though I had lost that money because of my incompetence, God had still cleaned it up and restored my money. Let's go to another second testimony. God opening the gate for me. So one time when I was doing Uber, I was delivering food. I went to a parking lot. It was DC, no, a parking garage in DC. I didn't see how much you're charging, but I only left my car there for like a few minutes. I came back. I was coming to the gate to pay. And then it was $20. I didn't have nothing in my account to pay it. I may have had a few dollars, but $20 was ridiculous to me. And so I was a little bit worried. I was like, I don't really have money in my account. I called the name of the Lord, and that gate had opened up for me. And then I just driven out. So even though I was incompetent and didn't check ahead of time to know how much money it's going to cost me to just put my car there for a few minutes, God still showed his glory in my mess. God still showed his glory in my mess. There was another time that God helped me with gas money. It was about maybe a year and a half ago. I was driving late at night, and my account was short on gas money. I don't think I felt comfortable asking someone, but God spoke to one of the prophetess at my church that they should give me gas money. See, even though I brought that mess upon myself, driving without much gas in my car and not making sure I have enough money ahead of time, God still came to the rescue in my mess. And this is going to be the final testimony. This is going to be a big one. I know one lady who, her and him are not married. So like months before they went into court for custody of the child, I had told her on several occasions, I was like, put this guy on child support. She wasn't doing it. Other people were telling her to put him on child support. So he finally took her to court for custody. He's the one who initiated the court thing. And she was so worried. She was so exhausted. She was so worried. But God still came to the rescue in her mess. God still came to the rescue. The judge ended up deciding on her favor and putting that guy on child support. Just like I had told her for months way before that. You see, even though we find ourselves in messes that are our fault, God is still faithful to us, merciful to us. So thank you very much. Please have a blessed one. I hope that God continues to bless and prosper.